Grace and peace in Jesus the Savior. Before we get into the message itself, I want to just address, you might notice, how come there's just one screen out? Well, we had a bulb blow, projector bulb blow, and the new one's not here yet. That's why just one screen. And this one's going to go soon. That's why it's so dim. Sorry. For those of you on the far right side, you might not see all the screen. If you want to scoot over, it's okay. There is an old Chinese curse. Well, at least the internet says it is, so it's got to be true. May you live in interesting times. And it is a curse. Interesting as a euphemism for difficult, as opposed to peaceful and calm. May you live in interesting times. Well, these are interesting times. These are difficult times for the church, for Christianity in America, in the West. Little snapshot. I mean, there's a lot of examples I could point out. One that I was reading about recently, I forget where it was. It was in our state. It was a city council meeting. And it was a custom in this town. I think it was in the Central Valley. To have a local clergy do an opening prayer before the council meeting. And so one of the pastors did prayer, just praying for blessing on the meeting and so forth. Everything's fine. So he concluded the prayer when he said, "In the name of Jesus, we pray." As soon as he said Jesus, some people in the audience started booing and saying, "Get that Jesus out of here." Wow. Wow, interesting times. You know, those of us who've been around a while, won't say getting older, have seen some dramatic changes in just a couple generations from a churched culture to a post-churched culture. And the place of Christianity, the place of the faith, the place of the church in society changed dramatically. We've seen things that were taken for granted in terms of accepted truth and basic morality were taken for granted for millennia. And now in a few short years are just washed away. And so the church finds itself in a place of changing from mainstream to extreme without changing anything that we confess. Here, an example of what I mean. When I say the word religious extremist, what comes to mind? What comes to mind, religious extremist? What comes to my mind is somebody who thinks they're serving God by blowing people up. Okay? All those awful pictures you see from time to time, people who think it's serving God to hateful signs up at funerals and things like that. I don't know if you've seen that. Awful. Religious extremists. Well, the Barna Group does a lot of surveying of our culture for the understanding how faith is changing in the culture. This is what their recent study showed, if you can see that or not. 60% of U.S. adults consider evangelism religious extremism. If I'm talking to you about my faith with the intent of trying to bring you to faith in Jesus, I'm a religious extremist. And amongst those who are unaffiliated, that means no faith, no church connection, 83% would call that religious extremism. That's our mission field. Do you see what's happened? The mission of God is religious extremism in America today. And it's growing. Right now, you take your Bible or your Bible on your phone or your app or whatever, a real Bible, and you're sitting at Starbucks publicly reading your Bible quietly. 11% of people will call you an extremist for that. And that's growing. So far, Only 7% of the population will call you an extremist for being here today. But that's growing. How do we get here? I guess the more important question is this. How do we live here? How do we live and thrive and grow and pursue the mission of God in this setting? Today we are starting a new series, an amazing book of the New Testament, 1 Peter, first epistle of Peter, a letter written to people going through very similar times, finding themselves in a very similar situation, although they got there in a very different way. So we're going to spend the next 8 weeks going through this amazing book and seeing what Peter has to say, what he said to the people that he's writing to, and what that says to us about living the living hope that we have in such difficult and interesting times. Now, let's look at it. I was going to ask you to look at your bulletin, but it's not printed out. If you want to, feel free to pull out your Bible on your phone or whatever to follow along as well. 1 Peter 1. But this is what Peter says in addressing, after introducing himself. This is how he addresses his hearers. He says this: to God's elect exiles scattered throughout the provinces of Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. Now, a couple things about this. It's amazing. He is writing to Jewish Christians. He's also writing to Gentile, that's non-Jewish people who've come to faith in Christ. Look how far Peter's come. This is Peter who had to be called out by Paul because he wouldn't eat with non-Jewish people. Now he's calling the Gentiles elect. See how far the Spirit's brought him? But the real point here is, who is he talking to? He is talking to these people in these Roman provinces. This is in, today we call it Turkey. There's a map of where those various provinces are. That he's writing to a pretty broad area. This is a broad letter, probably was copied quite a few times and circulated around. But this is what he's telling them, what he's calling them. Elect exiles. A little bit later, he's going to call them foreigners. Or in other words, resident aliens or strangers in a foreign land. But he's writing to people who are in their hometowns, who grew up there, who've lived there all their lives. And he's calling them foreigners and exiles. Why? Because that's what they feel like. And he knows because he's been through that himself. See, in his life, he came to faith in the risen Jesus. He who had been a faithful Jew now became a Jew who believed in the resurrection of Jesus, and suddenly he didn't fit in. That's what he grew up in. And that's what's happening in these areas. These people had come to faith in Christ, and that changed everything. Their hope, their beliefs, their lifestyle, their priorities, their activity changed everything. And now they're feeling like, we don't quite fit in here. What happened? And this is sometimes how all this change that's taking place in our culture can leave us feeling. We're in our hometown. We're in the places we live, places of all, maybe some of us have lived here our whole lives. But sometimes I don't feel like I fit in anymore. Because things changed. The values, the activities, what's right and what's wrong, and man, what's happened? Now, we got here by different routes. In Peter's readers, they changed. They changed. The culture around them stayed the same. They changed, and now they're feeling like they don't quite fit in. In our case, the basic teachings of the Christian church have not changed. But the culture around us has, dramatically. And we find ourselves in kind of the same place. Man, what happened? Feeling like we don't quite fit. Peter's readers, the situation was actually worse because they were experiencing persecution. It was just starting. It was going on in a variety of places. Peter himself would experience it in a couple years when he was in Rome. And Nero's persecution broke out and Peter was martyred. But they're having to deal with the beginnings of physical persecution. Now, we haven't had to deal with that here. Now, some of our brothers and sisters in Christ have. I'm thinking about that horrible bombing on Palm Sunday in Egypt. 46 of our brothers and sisters in Christ killed simply because they confessed Christ. It's not just a number of ISIS victims. They are our brothers and sisters in Christ. We need to keep those people and those places in our prayers. Persecution. The persecution that we might experience is more social or economic, but it does keep us in fear at times from speaking up. So this is what's going on. This is whom he's writing to. What's the point? Why is he writing? What does he want to bring about? What's the point of this book? Well, we see that in what else he calls them. He calls them elect exiles, foreigners, which is like a resident alien. But look what else he calls them. And we're going to see these in the upcoming weeks. Chosen people, royal priesthood, holy nation, God's special possession, people of God. And we can go on and on. We're going to see a bunch of these. See, this is his point. Yeah, it's tough times. It's interesting times. It's difficult times. But be encouraged. This is the point of 1 Peter. And I see three things going on here. The first is encouragement. They needed encouragement for their walk because of the difficulties that they're facing. Do we need encouragement sometimes in living our faith, pursuing our faith? Yeah, we do. We do, because things are tough. Things are more of a challenge than they used to be just to be the church. Sometimes we can feel like we're fighting a retreat. We can be encouraged. We can be encouraged. This is something that's happening in America, in Europe. Most of the rest of the world know. Global Christianity, the Spirit is moving. Amazing things happening in other parts of the world. We are part of, as Christianity is, just from a descriptive standpoint, the most successful, most widespread global faith movement ever. Ever. Jesus is being praised this morning in more languages and more cultures and more places and in more countries. Anyone, ever, any faith, ever. We're part of that. Be encouraged. So Peter is seeking to encourage with a living hope. We have a living hope, which we're going to unpack. A living hope that encourages us. He's going to talk about identity, who we are. In hard times, it is important to remember who you are. This is our covenant identity. Remember, covenant and kingdom. Our covenant identity. Who we are, what we have been given. We'll see that in this book. To encourage us. And then also practically living. Go from being to doing. Kingdom representatives. How then do we live? How do we live? How do we live as Christians when we're a minority faith? Because that's what's becoming. And we don't know how to do it. We could learn a lot from our brothers and sisters in China, in Africa, in India. We can learn a lot from them about how to be a Christian faithfully, how to pursue the mission when you're a minority faith. We keep stumbling. We keep stumbling over this, thinking that the answer is in public denunciations and slogans and trying to get political legislation passed. Early church didn't do any of that. It thrived. How do we live in such interesting, difficult times? How do we pursue the mission? How do we live our faith? Peter has a lot to say about that to his readers at the time that goes right into our lives today. And we're going to look at that. Now today, So look at a few of the verses that were part of our second reading. He's focusing on identity to encourage us, who we are. After saying to those of you in these Roman provinces, then he identifies them further. He says this, who have been chosen according to the foreknowledge of God the Father through the sanctifying work of the Spirit to be obedient to Jesus Christ and sprinkled with his blood, grace and peace be yours in abundance. That's his actual greeting, grace and peace. But look how he identifies them. Did you notice the Trinity? God the Father, Spirit, Jesus Christ. It's about identity. We have an identity, covenant identity, given to us by our God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. That identity was just given to Thomas a few minutes ago in baptism. He's baptized in the name of Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Peter's reminding them of that. This is your identity. And look what Father, Son, Holy Spirit has done for you. Chosen you. You have been chosen and loved by God before you were born. Sanctified. You are forgiven, renewed by the Holy Spirit. Sprinkled with his blood. That is Old Testament sacrificial atonement language. For Jesus died for you to make you his own. That's our identity. I'm chosen. I'm sanctified. I've been redeemed. For what purpose? What's the goal? He has that there as well, to be obedient to Jesus Christ, to follow Jesus. The being flows into doing. I'm following Jesus. Well, that's how Peter is, in an encouraging way, identifying them and reminding them of who they are. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, chosen, sanctified, redeemed, that you might follow Jesus. And then he goes on to talk about what they have been given, a living hope. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth, another baptism reference, into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. Inheritance. You've been given an inheritance. Inheritance is a gift. It's not earned. It's a gift to you that can never spoil, fade, or perish. Things don't last, do they? Things don't last. Things change. This will not change. Your inheritance, that is the kingdom of God, the new creation, resurrection, peace with God, that inheritance is being guarded, Peter says, by God himself. Nothing can take it away. The worst that this life can throw at you, the worst persecution, Peter would say to his readers, cannot touch your inheritance. Absolutely secure. Be encouraged. You have this inheritance. And because of that, a living hope. When he says a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus. Oh, come to the Wednesday night class, like I said. We will unpack that. Don't have time to get into it all right now. But it's the sure and certain fact of the resurrection that is the foundation of this living hope. It's not wishful thinking. It's not just pious wishes. It's reality based on what God has done and what he has promised. Living hope that is built on this confidence that the worst of this world can throw at us cannot take away what God has given us. That the suffering that does come our way will be used by God for blessing. And the best is yet to come. A living hope that shapes our lives. So, okay, then what difference does this make in difficult times, in interesting times? Peter's going to go from being to doing. He goes on. In all this, you greatly rejoice. Though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief and all kinds of trials. Here it is, the interesting, difficult times. These have come so that the proven genuineness of your faith, of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Now, I highlighted that, of greater worth than gold. The first thing Peter is reminding them of has to do with priority. Priority. Your faith in this living hope, this inheritance, this God who has chosen, sanctified, redeemed you, that faith is the most important thing in your life. This relationship with God is the most important thing. Priority. Is my faith, is being a disciple and growing as a disciple, is that priority one in my life? Is that a mere hobby? Something I do in my spare time when all the more important things are taken care of? Are my commitments to God, whether it's prayer time, word time, worship time, the first to be pushed aside when other things come up? Priority. Priority. You know, this is one of the things that we would learn from our brothers and sisters in places like India, China, Middle East. And that's this. If discipleship, being a disciple, is not job one, not top priority, my relationship with Christ, top priority, in the environment that we're talking about here, our faith will be swept away. We will not survive. We are living this now. We've got most of a generation swept right out of the church because the church is relying too much on the culture for discipleship. And when the culture changed, our discipleship wasn't adequate to the task. When I was in India a few years ago, it was on a Sunday, and I may have told some of this before. It was a Sunday I was asked to preach, which was quite an experience. Preach, and then the translator would translate. And afterwards, we had a time to gather for lunch and to spend most of the afternoon with a variety of Mission India workers, church planters, children's Bible club leaders, literacy trainers. We had about 12 of them there. And we're just hearing their stories and spending some time with them. And it was a great afternoon. But what really struck me was, I should have brought a picture of them. Three young ladies. And I spent some time talking with them because they're the same age as my two older daughters. They're Heidi's age. Three young ladies. They're church planters. And pretty young for that. And they're talking about their experiences. And one of them had been beaten up for her faith. The other two chased from towns twice. And I said, I asked them, how do you keep going on? Why do you keep doing this? How do you do this? And they looked at each other, and one of them actually was giggling a little bit. I said, this is what we do. Jesus is our Lord. We have to follow him. I felt like a little infant Christian. I felt these young ladies, they know more about following Jesus than I do. I felt like a lot of what we do back here is church is a hobby. Wow. Is discipleship job one? Is it a priority? Following Jesus, growing in him. Found a few interesting memes about priorities. Your priorities aren't what you say they are revealed by how you live. It's easy to claim priority for Jesus here. How do we live? Change your priorities and you change your life. It's that simple. Changing your life, there's a churchy word for that. It's called repentance. In order to say yes to your priorities, you have to be willing to say no to something else. That's the one I struggle with. I keep piling stuff on. Here's something from Jesus on priorities. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. We just heard those words, right? Seek first. And all the other things you might worry about, God will take care of that. In another setting, Jesus put it much more graphically and more blunt. this call to priorities. Luke 9, 23, 25. Then he said to them all, whoever wants to be my disciples must deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me. Whoever wants to save their life will lose it. Whoever loses their life for me will save it. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world and yet forfeit or lose their very self? Wow. He calls us to follow him. You see here with Peter's words, with Jesus' words, there's this beautiful, beautiful invitation. You are chosen. You are redeemed. You are sanctified. You are full of grace and peace. You have a living hope and an inheritance that cannot fade. And this challenge, where are your priorities? Is God calling you? Is he calling me to reorder my priorities that I might follow him as he's called me to live? We live in interesting times. We live in challenging times, difficult times. We are blessed deeply. We have such cause to be encouraged. Such cause to be encouraged of what God is doing and has done for us. May the Lord bless each of us in our following him as disciples, in our ordering of our priorities, in our living of our faith, as we seek to live out of the living hope in interesting times. Would you pray with me? We are so blessed in you, Lord. Chosen, sanctified, redeemed. Inheritance that can't fade. We praise you, Lord, for that. And the living hope that we have in you. But you call us to follow. You call us to live. You call us, Lord, to have no other gods before you. You call us to deny ourselves and take up our cross and follow. Help us, Lord, to do that. Show us where we need to reorder our priorities. Show us where we need to make changes in order to follow you more faithfully, to hear your word, to spend time with you, and to be your hands and feet in a challenging world. Lead us, our Jesus. Amen.